Going to ask now that
Courtney Dolores Taylor would bring her parents forward. Right here, up close. And now, grandparents, come. Get on his other side. Amen. Now the rest of the family may come, and well-wishers and supporters may come, please. Just gather around anywhere, on this side, down around the front. Courtney.
Yes. Hi.
Yeah, I'm glad to see you.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
To those of you who are visiting our church for the first time, baby blessings are a big deal at CPC. Last year we had a baby born for every month of the year, plus 16 babies in 1 year. I think you had something to do with that activity. Charles and Tina, the pastor's mind was drawn to this interesting passage in the book of Revelation. Listen to the words. And there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she, being with child, cried, travailing in birth, and pained to be delivered. And there appeared another wonder in heaven. And behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and 7 crowns upon his heads. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven, and he did cast them to the earth. Now the drama gets nervous. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. We know who studied Revelation, the symbolisms of the church. The child is Christ, and the dragon is the devil. It's all explained in Revelation 12, 9, and 10. But the symbolism for Tina and Charles cannot be missed. Nor can it be missed by this congregation. For your pastor believes that every time a baby is born, the devil waits to devour. That's the message, Charles. For every child born is a potential candidate for the kingdom of God. Nothing angers and agitates the devil more than to know there will be another human being he can't have. That's right, Charles. Thank you, Jesus. But you can see, therefore, Charles and Tina, the responsibility incumbent upon you. For the devil waits to devour her. Who is her protection? A Christian father and a Christian mother. Filled with the Holy Spirit. Whose hearts are given to Jesus, whose life, as I'll talk about in my sermon today, is knit with prayer, whose marriage is a living spiritual example of how God can knit two diverse hearts together and make them one. She must breathe the atmosphere of your love. She must feast on the meals of your faith. She must grab hold of the Word of God as it is shared in your home. The little songs, Tina, getting her in that Sabbath school. Oh, yes, she'll tear up the Sabbath school quarterly. That's all right. Put it in her little fat hands anyhow. And the time will come when you'll teach her to sit in church. Don't take her out every time. Just lay your hand firmly on them little thighs and say, uh-uh. She'll get the message. Why? Because the devil seeks to devour. He devours our children through their minds. So the little children are taught to sing, oh, be careful, little ears, what you hear. Oh, be careful, little mouth, what you say. Oh, be careful, little eyes, what you see. For the Father up above looks down with great love. And so I charge you today. I was thinking, I had the privilege of doing the premarital counseling, baptized you, Charles, then the marriage. Now you got me blessing babies. Lord have mercy. Well, Pastor enjoys every bit of it. I'm very proud of you two. You can see the church family loves you. Loves you very dearly. But your child now must be guarded, Tina. Your child must be guarded. She must never see anything out of her daddy that's demonic or sense a spirit from her mother that is unchristlike. It's through that means that the devil devours what the child experiences through us. May the Lord bless you both. And so if you dedicate yourself today, you too, before we dedicate your child, to a life in Christ for the sake of your child, would you please say, I do.
I do.
Hey, you said that before. Oh, my, this is just too much for the pastor. Give her a hand. Yeah. Let's pray. Little Courtney, I give you back to your maker. He loves you. He created you. He died for you. I give you hip to him in all that you are, your mind, your body, your talents, your gifts. I pray that you will love him, that you'll get to know him. I pray that one day your hand will touch his face. I pray that you will respect your parents and you'll listen to those older than you as they give you guidance. I pray, Courtney, that you'll come to love church and the word and the hymns. I pray, Courtney, that one of your first words after no and yes will be Jesus. I pray, Courtney, that you'll be saved in the kingdom of God. Now I dedicate you, not by my authority, by the authority of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. In his name we have prayed, and all the people said,
Amen.
Amen. And now, family, if you dedicate yourself to see that the prayer just prayed becomes real in this child's life, would you say, we will?
Amen.
And congregation, as you accept one more pair of little legs to run between us, to be an example to her, would the congregation say, Amen.
Amen.
You did good.
A
as is our custom here, we're giving another baby dedication certificate to Courtney Dolores Taylor, who was born September 16, 2008 at Holy Cross Hospital and is presented today by Katina and Charles Taylor.
Amen.
On the 20th day of February 2009 by Senior Pastor Henry Wright, Community Praise Center, Seventh-day Adventist Church. And then we also give you the book Child Guidance.
Yes, Lord.
Written by Ellen G. White years and years and years ago, but very relevant for today in raising your child. It will guide you through the happy times and the rough times. Just keep trusting.
Amen.
And as Pastor said, keep her before the Lord each and every day, because the devil is out to get our children. This will give you insight into things that you never knew before. And as I said, it's relevant for what you are facing today as you raise your baby. May God bless you and continue to bless you as you raise your family for Him. There you go. Thank you.
You may have her. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Yeah, I'll see you. Yeah, leave my tie alone. Bless you.
Thank you, Pastor.
Bless you, boy. God bless you. You may return to your seats.
Good afternoon again, church. We are blessed this afternoon to have our silent praise brought to us by the Youth of the Way. Amen?
Amen.
It will be under the direction of Takesha Tolles. It's a new American Sign Language praise team, Everlasting Inspiration. Let's welcome them. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. The scripture reading today is taken from the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 1, verse 27. And I'll also turn the page and find Genesis chapter 2, verses 24 and 25. Genesis 1, 27, and Genesis 2, 24 and 25. I will read in your hearing. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. Genesis 2:24. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. May God add a rich blessing to the reading, hearing, and doing of his holy word.
Thank you.
Amen. How many ways in heaven will we praise the Lord? Next week, the opening line of my sermon will be, "Your children are at their worst when they act most like you." Let us pray. Kind Father, lead us now into the study of your book. In Christ's name, amen. We welcome those who are joining us around the world. And invite you to turn in your Bibles with us as we worship today. Let's go back to the book of Genesis, the second chapter, verses 24 and 25. "Therefore shall a man leave his father and his brother and shall cleave, father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and the twain shall be how many? And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed." I started last week's sermon with this sentence: "The choice we make for a person to date or court or be engaged to or marry is a direct reflection of our spiritual level at the time we make the choice." And it's been interesting, the calls I've gotten this week, people saying, "Pastor, you're right. You are correct." I want to begin today's message with this sentence: marriage is a spiritual relationship, not just a physical one. Therefore, its challenges can be successfully met only by two genuinely spiritual people using genuinely spiritual principles. Now, thus far in this series of sermons on the Holy Ghost, we have learned the Holy Ghost is a gift planned, promised by Jesus to the church. Where the Holy Ghost is, there is action. Three, the Holy Ghost first contacts us in order to lead us to Christ as Savior. For the Holy Ghost's presence given us at the beginning of our Christian walk is not sufficient to see us to the end of that walk. Five, the last days in filling of the Holy Spirit must first be preceded by cleansing out of your life. Six, the Holy Spirit empowers us to stand for truth. Seven, the Holy Spirit needs to be honored and thanked and recognized and included in every aspect of your life. What do you say, church? Eight, we learn that our temperament, though a natural asset, be we melancholic, choleric, sanguine, or phlegmatic, though a natural asset, our temperament can be a detriment if not under the control of the Holy Spirit. Because as we study those temperaments, we found out they have both a positive and a negative, don't they? And the natural thing for a human being to do is to play to the negative side of who they are. But if they're in Christ, I'll say it again. If they're in Christ, something different can happen. We learn, number 9, that our natural God-given temperament has both good and bad, but by applying the fruit of the Spirit, thank you, Jesus, the Holy Ghost can overrule the bad and strengthen the good. And then, number 10, we learned last week that the Holy Ghost must guide you in the successful choice of a mate. And the Holy Ghost's standards must be your standards. In short, most people marry for the wrong reasons. Spirituality is not on the list. Or they think of it later when they realize they got a mess on their hands. Now, the most irresponsible thing that a pastor can do or a presenter can do on the subject of marriage is act like that in one sermon he's going to cover the whole mess. I think I have in my files over 50 presentations, workshops on marriage. Have never covered the whole subject. And they're all kind of books. Some of you have them. Some folk are constantly reading books about marriage. They just need to get about being married, but they're constantly reading books about marriage. They want to be empowered. That's a big phrase now, you know, Carlson. Empowerment. Empowerment comes from the Holy Spirit. Amen. And the thing you got to recognize, though, a lot of the books are good. A lot of the books are good. A lot of the folk who wrote those books have bad marriages. So ultimately, it's not how much knowledge you have. It helps. It's what you're doing. I'll say amen for you. If you're having a hard time saying amen, I'll say amen for you. So I make no effort today to try to do what has not been done. This sermon doesn't cover the whole deal. In fact, I've narrowed this sermon to that statement. Marriage is a spiritual relationship, not a physical one. Its challenges, second statement, can only be successfully met by two genuinely spiritual people. And so, first of all, in the sermon, we'll talk about the nature of marriage. And then we will talk about some of the non-negotiable, what word did I just say? Non-negotiable. Spiritual principles that must apply. You see, there are some things, Tina, if you and Charles are going to work for the next 75, let's go for 75, years, there's got to be some stuff, come on, y'all, that you must do. Can I get a witness? Some stuff can't be left out. We'll talk about some of those principles. Now, one of the reasons why I'm setting you up now for where I'm going, one of the reasons why I think the subject of marriage is inexhaustible is because the relationship is by nature so godly. Let me break that down. Building a marriage relationship over the years, and it takes years. Years, y'all. So if you're just getting started, you got a few problems, you just hang on in there. You ain't seen nothing yet. See, first of all, before you can fix it, all the broken parts have to be on the table. And most of us come into marriage hiding broken parts. So it takes the pressure of marriage to get all the brokenness on the table, then you can get to fixing. It takes about 7 to 10 years to get all the stuff on the table. That's why when someone comes to me in 7 to 10 years, nobody wants to get a divorce, I say, for what? You don't know enough to get a divorce. You don't know what you're divorcing. You don't know you. Now, if they're beating you up and, you know, knocking your head through the wall, that's another situation. But In most cases, it takes a few years to just find out what's going on, because we kind of unfold slowly. Don't we unfold slowly? You know when you married, you didn't tell everything. Sit there looking at me. There's stuff you did not say. But marriage is a pressure cooker. Go on and say amen, married folk. And sooner or later, it all rises to the top. Doesn't it? Then, should have prayed before, but then you really learn how to pray. You show me folks who've been married for 30, 40 years, I'll show you some praying Negroes, some praying people. Praying. I mean, you've learned to agonize with God. All right, well, stay calm here. Stay calm. It takes years. But I was making the point, why is the subject of marriage so inexhaustible? I was making that point. It is because, listen to the pastor, the marriage relationship parallels our relationship with Jesus Christ. Show me a person. Nice to meet you and your husband, lovely folks. Show me a person. Listen to the pastor. Show me a person who is learning to be a Christian, and I'll show you a person who probably can make a good spouse. Because it takes some of the same stuff. First of all, to be successful in a relationship with Jesus Christ, you must be submissive and be willing to be changed. And you know if a marriage is going to work, you got to be submissive. That wasn't loud enough. Amen. Two folks have to blend, and that that takes giving up some stuff. And the fact is, if you're going to stay married, you're going to give up way more than you had in mind when you said, I do. So there's parallels. Now, when the pastor says spiritual, what does he mean? In this sermon, the word spiritual is to be defined as something that is God-initiated and God-sustained. So I'm saying that, CJ, marriage must be God-initiated. So when you choose somebody to live with, you're living with somebody. I'm a blessed man. I live with a sweet human being. You know, I feel sorry for these folks that got to come home with somebody who's got a bad mouth and attitude. I've never experienced that. Sister Wright is just pleasant. You know, that's a blessing. You know, let me just sit down here and just thank God. That's a blessing. That's a blessing. Yeah. All the kind of stuff I got to deal with, and to come home to somebody who's mean, no. Sweet. Now, she can jack me up, but she's sweet. Never raises her voice. Them green eyes turn purple. I know there's trouble in the house. Sweet. What I'm saying is, to live together a long time, you need to have God in that thing, because, see, God knows what's coming down the line, and God knows what they didn't tell you when they married you. Trust him. So what's the issue? Well, let's get into it. Don't worry about the cough. I'm fine. Marriage is couched in spiritual terms in the Bible. Let's read some of them. Genesis 1. I'm just establishing now in the Bible, Eric, that marriage is couched in spiritual terms in the Bible. That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm dealing with, Cliff, right now. That's all I'm dealing with. Genesis, I'm going to move fast now. Move fast. Can't be here all day. Genesis 1:27. So God, look. So God did what? So see, the whole thing was started by God. So God created who? Man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. He took his hymnus, made it male and female. Ain't no in between here. Amen. and almost maybe just about male and female. He didn't divide himself into four parts. Ain't no trans, nothing here. Male and female. I'm reading the Bible. God's word. And then God, who did it? So notice in the two texts, both texts start with God. So marriage, maleness and female, that's God. So the whole, the two sexes, God. Bringing them together, God. Look at Genesis 2:18. See it? See it? Well, what are the first things you see in that text, 2:18? Who said it? And the Lord God said it's not good for man to be alone. So the whole marriage concept came out of the mind of God. Now, I'm going to tell you something. Only God could think of something called marriage. Two different folk, two different backgrounds, two different sexes, two different sets of DNA. Only God could think that would work. Only God. So, see, and the foundation I'm laying, see, if you're going to go into marriage without God, it's his idea. How are you going to work it without God? It's like taking your Rolls Royce to be serviced at Sears and Roebuck. Sears. I'm old. See, it used to be a Roebuck. Got to take it to the Rolls Royce dealer. So, marriage in the Bible is a God. Look at verse 21. Verse 21. And there it is again. What does verse 21 start with, y'all? And the Lord God caused deep sleep to fall upon Adam. And he slept and took one of his ribs, closed up the flesh instead thereof, and the rib which the Lord, who made the rib? Had taken from man, made who? He, a woman, and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called. Yeah, he took a good look at Eve. He said, whoa, man. Some of y'all, yeah. Downstairs, did y'all get it? Yeah. But notice all these texts, the pastor is reading God, 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 God. So I don't apologize to you for saying that if you're going to have a successful marriage, God must be in it. It's his idea. Look at Proverbs 18:22. It's over there by Psalms. Proverbs 18:22. Can't wait on you. Yeah, see? Whoso findeth a wife findeth a good thing and obtaineth favor where? Of the Lord. See, notice it. Now notice this, Ken. I have not read one marriage text that does not have the Lord's name in it. See, I'm trying to get something in your head, Vanessa. That this idea of people drifting into marriage without prayer, without God, it's Russian roulette. Even with God, there are going to be challenges. Can I get a witness in the house? Without him, you don't have a prayer. Mark 10:9. Bible's consistent throughout its pages. Mark 10:9. Yeah. We quote this in the marriage ceremony, John. Look at this. What therefore God hath joined, who joined it?
God.
Let no man put asunder. Now the question is, did God join it? But again, I have yet to find, and you see, so if you meet somebody in an ungodly place, and you and the person carry on ungodly activity, And you expect to have a successful marriage violating the principles of the God who made it? And so Mark says, what God hath joined together. So that raises a question. I'm going to let you answer it. Did God join you? Ephesians. Ephesians tears you up. If you think marriage is not spiritual, read Ephesians 5. No escape from this one. Ephesians 5. Now, this is serious. This is serious. And note the consistency. Note the consistency, John. Look. Submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. See? You can't get into a marriage biblical statement without God. I want you to get that. So simple, but often missed. Wives, submit yourselves unto your husbands as unto the Lord. In there again, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is in there, is head of the church, and he is the savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto, so let the wives be to their own husbands and everything. Then husbands, love your wives, even as man, this is wonderful. Christ. Now, I got news for you. Hope for you. We know, let's be honest, a lot of folk get involved without Christ. Going to get married without Christ. But if those two people let Christ come in, he can take two people who probably never should have got married and work a miracle. Now, don't gamble on that. The thing that is majestic about God, getting carried away now, I love him. His unusual, magnificent, immeasurable, constant, overflowing ability to take our junk and build a house. Because some of us didn't know the Lord when we got married. So don't be discouraged. Be a Christian. But now you're saying, Pastor, what's the point? We already know that marriage is a spiritual relationship. I mean, why are you beating that horse to death? Well, because I know that far too many marriages are born in non-spiritual circumstances. And as we pointed out last week, far too many times our criteria, you see, folk, our criteria for choosing a mate so often omits or puts last the spiritual issues. See, the first question you ought to ask is this person one who'll help me go to heaven? We tend to ask that question after we've fallen in love, after we're pregnant, after we've joined finances, after we've gotten hooked on how fine they are, after. And see, once you've gotten that far, then it's hard for you to hear the Holy Spirit. See, I can almost tell. You've been around as long as I have, counseling marriages. I can always tell somebody comes to my office, somebody will say they want to know if they should get married. I can almost tell after 5 minutes whether they really come there to find out if they should get married, or whether they came there to get married. Most people, once they make up their mind they're going to get married, freight train can't stop them. Now, folk, I've been there. I'm not just saying, I've been there. And you can lay out all kind of stuff. But we love each other. Now, I really need to preach a whole separate sermon on the word love. The most misused word in the English language. We use it for everything, don't we? Love the car, love the house, love the movie, love fried chicken, love our wife. So we got the same emotions for a dead bird you got for your wife. So don't come to me with that love stuff. I done heard it. A 2-year-old can use the word love. Don't mean squat. The Bible cries out in defiance, God is love. Therefore, true love is godly. So a lot of stuff being called love ain't never been and never will be. All that was free. Wasn't in my notes at all. Just stuck it in. Now, how does this spiritual thing work? Genesis 1:26. And God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. First thing you bring to a spiritual marriage is God's likeness. What do you bring? Yeah, God's likeness. God's likeness comes, Damon, as you seek the Lord. In other words, the person you get involved with, you marry, they must already know the Lord. See, don't, when I hear somebody say, that I'm winning them to Christ. That's interesting. Only the Holy Spirit wins people. So if they've not already allowed Christ to do something in them, then you're leaning over on one side. You're trying to carry them and you too. You can't do it. So both must bring God's image. What must they bring? Then 1:27, so God created man in his own image. Image of God created he them, male and female created he them. The second they bring is God's sexuality. God's sexuality. You know, God loves sex. Why are y'all afraid to say amen? It's his idea. You never thought of sex. God thought of sex. It's his idea. He loves it. In the proper context. What the devil does is try to distort your concept of sexuality before you marry, so you come in with all kind of kinky stuff in your head. Well, I'm sorry, visitors, I'm a very straight preacher. Very clear. Come in with all kind of, you know, hang-ups. And your partner ain't got them same hang-ups, and you... So you have to submit every part of yourself, your drives, to Jesus before you say I do. Come on and say amen out there. And then, first you bring God's image, then God's sexuality, then 2:24 and 25, therefore shall a man leave his father. That's focus. You got to bring focus. Married folks have to stay focused on their marriage. Not everybody else's marriage, their marriage. Your marriage. Not my marriage. Your marriage. Leave his father and mother. Leave the father and mother. Therefore shall the man and the woman leave the father and mother. Leave mom and daddy out of this thing. Cleave. Cleave. It's from the Hebrew word for concrete, a mixture of sand and cement and water. Sand, cement, and water. Now, I don't care whether she's the sand or you the sand, you the cement, she's the cement, you know, sand and water. And water is the Holy Ghost. Amen. Got to cleave one to another. And you know, cement has to settle, doesn't it? Early on, you can step on it and leave marks. But as it hardens up, then it takes a sledgehammer to break them two folk up. Come on and say amen out there. Hallelujah, Jesus! And then it says they shall be one flesh. Didn't say unanimity, unity. No husband and wife are always going to agree. And I become highly suspicious. Somebody, we always get along. You're married to a corpse. You can always get along with a corpse. No. Follow the pastor now. Here's the sentence you don't want to mention. It is not important that husband and wives only agree, always agree. It is important that they always understand. That's unity. You want to be married to someone who's got their own mind. Come on, somebody. Their own thoughts, their own opinions to balance yours. Because most human beings are half crazy. So you need that same part of your spouse to match up with yours. Come on and say amen out there. We're twisted. You know we got kinks and hang-ups. Nobody's all together. There's no such thing as a sane human being. Have you figured that out yet? Everybody's a little crazy. I've been done figured that thing out. I've been pastoring for 40-some years. I know that. But when you come together to understand, so you just reach an understanding, and then you learn over the years. Don't keep arguing about the same thing over and over again. Particularly if it's not a salvation issue. We waste so much energy. If it's about salvation, hang in there, stand firm. If it's about who's going to make up the bed, leave that thing alone. Leave the bed unmade. You're going to get in it tonight anyhow. Don't leave the thing unmade. Break up a marriage over a bed. He won't make up the bed. So what? You won't get a new wig. You know, it's just. Then verse 25 says, and they were both naked. They both what? Naked. They were both what? Talk to me. Naked. The word means vulnerable. It's not talking about clothes. It's talking about openness, honesty, vulnerability. You see, brothers and sisters, when you finally meet somebody, let me talk about this thing, Jesus. When you finally meet somebody, see, I'm talking about marriage as much like the relationship with Jesus Christ. When you finally, Jacob, meet somebody who can know the worst about you and know your weak points and not take advantage of you, glory! Hallelujah! Who loves you through your pain and loves you through your weakness and loves you through your downtime. Someone who says, they're naked, but I'm going to cover them with my love. Hallelujah. That's what Jesus does. That's how spiritual marriage works. And then you got to do something else. Genesis 24, 1 through 4. Is this a good sermon? Yeah, I know it is. Genesis 24, 1 through 4. And Abraham, watch the pastor now. And Abraham was old. Abraham was old and well stricken in age. And the Lord blessed Abraham in all things. Watch this text. Do not miss this text. And Abraham said unto his eldest servant of his house that ruled over all that he had, put, I pray thee, thy hand under my thigh. And I will make thee swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of earth, that thou shalt not take a wife unto my son of the daughters of the Canaanites, among whom I dwell, but thou shalt go into my country and to my kindred and take a wife unto my son Isaac. The next thing you've got to do, after you've practiced those other spiritual principles, God's image, God's sexuality, focus, commitment, cleave, so forth, unity, not unanimity, transparency, Abraham said, I want someone to marry my son who has a common spiritual dimension. See, Allison, that's why I keep coming back to this thing. We're trying to form successful unions with unbelievers. Now, I know y'all don't like to hear me talk about this. You get all nervous and upset and get stiff sitting in the pew. Well, just sit there stiff, because I'm going to tell you now. It's a biblical principle. Don't get tied up with folks that don't have your same belief system. In fact, in Genesis 26, it says that Isaac and Rebekah were grieved when their son Esau married outside the church. Grieved. And then in Judges 3, we'll go there. This is powerful, Judges 3. Those of you who are turning me off right now, just stay turned off. But it's gonna come back on you. Lord, help you. I pray for you. Judges 3. Did I say Judges? Yeah. All right, Judges 3, verse 5. I can't wait on you. And the children of Israel dwelt among the Canaanites. Look at that. Dwelt among the Canaanites, the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, the Hivites, Jebusites. Watch the ites. Watch the ites. Them ites will get you every time, brother. And they're all around you. They get Alexandria and Upper Marlboro and D.C. and Columbia. Them ites are everywhere. Watch them ites. Let me finish. And they took their daughters to be their wives and gave their daughters to their sons and served their gods. Now look at verse 7. And the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord. The direct result of mixing belief systems in a marriage caused the believer to compromise. The non-believer did not compromise. And folk, I've seen, my wife and I have seen that thing in the church. Somebody comes, oh my, well, you know, and all this thing. And then look up, you're the one compromising. They stand right where they are. They ain't moved an inch. A marriage is a spiritual relationship. And so the decisions must be made spiritually. And so the Bible is replete with the sad stories of how a non-spiritual person tied up with a person who was not spiritual, where a spiritual person tied up with a person who was not spiritual or of another belief system. I mean, look at Ahab and Jezebel. Solomon and his many wives. Them wives just took him out. Of course, a brother with that many wives. There's another sermon, so I ain't going there. I made this point earlier in the sermon, shifting now. Building a marriage relationship over the years, and it does take years, incorporates some of the same principles that are required to be in relationship with the Almighty God. The main set of principles that Jesus gave us to guide our life are the Ten Commandments. What did I say? Jesus in John 14, 15 said, if you love me, do what? You ever thought about the commandments and marriage? Let's go team up there. Commandments and marriage. First commandment says, thou shalt have no other gods before me. The first law of marriage is put God first. Do what? Put God first. Let me say it again. If they don't bring God with them into the relationship, you're in trouble. They got to bring their part of God. You got to bring your part of God. And you can't carry their part of God for them. Second commandment says, don't make any graven images. Some of the graven images, Larry Marable, of marriage are nice home, nice cars. Come on, y'all. Both have good jobs. Are you with me? education, and you begin to measure the success of your marriage by these idols. A successful marriage is not measured by how much stuff you've accumulated, but how close are both of you to Jesus Christ, and how close are you now in compared to how close you were when you started. So the second commandment is the marriage commandment, third commandment. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Folk, if you're going to call yourself a Christian marriage, then it's got to have two Christian people. To stand before a Christian pastor, now pronounce you husband and wife by the power and authority invested in me. What God hath joined us together, let no man put asunder. Those words are meaningless if the two people the pastor is saying it to are not really Christian. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain when it comes to your marriage. Are you listening to me? Yes. Fourth commandment, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. A marriage without worship. Come on, y'all. The Sabbath allows a family, that's why we're here today, to come aside and remember the Lord who created the marriage. There are two abiding institutions that come down from Eden, the Sabbath and marriage. And on the seventh day, they should come together, husbands and wives, with their children, walking in the church on God's holy day. Come on and say amen out there. Marriage is bound together, bound together by worship, by extolling God. Fifth commandment, honor your father and your mother. Two ways this commandment applies to marriage. Number one, many husbands and wives become mothers and fathers. And you ought to respect one another as such. The father of a woman's children ought to be treated as that. The mother of a man's children ought to be treated as that. Never contribute to the disrespect of your spouse in terms of the children. God have mercy upon you. Some of our mouths need to be sealed shut until Jesus comes. We say stuff in front of the children to demean our spouses. Take your argument to the bedroom, outside. Arguing and fussing in the car and the kids sitting in the back seat wondering what in the world is going on. Throwing things at one another in the house. We ought to be ashamed of ourselves. Because then those children will grow up either disrespecting what it means to be a father or disrespecting what it means to be a mother based on what they saw us say and do. There's a second way that commandment applies to the marriage. All of us come from mothers and fathers. Now, I know that in a marriage, many times we bring the pain of not having been well-fathered or well-mothered. But you know, that commandment is a strong one, Keith. Didn't say honor your father and your mother because they were good. It says honor your father and your mother. See, God puts something special on that position. So if you got to hang out with your parents and so forth and so on, you need to settle that. Don't bring that into the marriage. If you marry someone who's got to hang out with their parents, they bring those hang-ups into the relationship. So the fifth commandment is key to a successful marriage, a spiritual relationship. Thou shalt not kill. Now, we know that sometimes this emotion comes upon you in a marriage. I mean, gotta sit down on this one, Keith. The commandment can be taken literally. Thou shalt not take out your spouse. But the commandment also is talking about, you remember Jesus applied it to the mouth. To the mouth. You can kill one another. You know, see, Sister Wright knows me better than anybody. She really does. And so she can say things that would just twist me to pieces And even if you said it and you were right, I'd ignore you. I know you. I don't have to live with you. I don't know. But Sister Wright says it. See what I'm saying? Some of us have said things to our spouses. God help us. They've never gotten over. There is power in being a spouse, and some of us misuse our power. We know we can bring them down. We know we can tear them up. We know we can demean them. And then we do it in front of people. And the God who knows every dirty thing you've done does not expose you in front of folk. How dare you expose your spouse in front of folk? If they're dumb and stupid and ain't worth a dime, then some dumb, stupid, not worth a dime person chose them. Thou shalt not kill. Words that lift a person. Or if they're wrong, tell them. But don't strip a person down. And when you have such inner insecurity that you got to pull your spouse down to nothing to feel good about yourself, something wrong with you. You need help. Move in with a psychologist and stay there till you're well. We have no right to take our spouse and reduce them verbally. Thou shalt not kill. Next commandment. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Next commandment. The seventh needs no exposition. Eighth commandment. Thou shalt not steal. Thievery in a marriage is terrible. No, I ain't talking about stealing money out of your wife's purse. That too. You're stealing money out of his purse. Watch the pastor. Stealing time. Stealing love. Stealing priority. Stealing from them their dignity and self-respect. It ties right in with thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not steal. See, one of the most important things that goes on in a marriage is time together. It's precious, isn't it? The time you spend together. And folk, don't take that for granted. One of the big dangers about being married is being married. And you get tied up. Listen to the pastor. You know I love every last one of you. I love every last one of you. You get tied up in the things and the stuff. And you start stealing from one another love and affection and patience and words of affirmation and encouragement. Encourage your spouse. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Commandment number 9. Don't lie. Don't lie. See, let me tell you. Keep that commandment up there. Let me tell you. Listen to the pastor. The most important thing in a marriage, aside from love, is trust. Whoo! And many times, Mama Lee, when couples come in before me and they're going at one another, I listen. Doesn't take me long to figure out that the real problem is trust. Somebody hurt somebody down the line and they got defensive. And you see, here's the thing about it, folk. It is hard to love somebody with your arm up. If you're trying to be in love and be loved and protect yourself at the same time, you're in the wrong business. Marriage is the ultimate vulnerability. Got to drop your guard, try it again. They may have done so and so and so. You may have caught them. So what? If you stayed with them, and you're going to spend the next 15 years keep bringing that stuff up, then go on and be a man or woman. Go on and get a divorce and live by yourself. If you're going to stay with them, you got to lay that thing down. Come on, somebody! Commandment 10, thou shalt not covet. That is, be satisfied with what you got. Don't come to CPC looking around. And so the Lord gives us, let's put our last slide up there, the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit. Yeah. Love to deal with your hate. Joy to deal with your sadness and complaining and depression. Peace to deal with your worry and inner turmoil that so many of us bring into marriage. Long suffering to deal with your impatience and intolerance. Gentleness to deal with your harshness and indifference and revengeful spirit. Goodness to deal with your selfishness and self-centeredness. Faith to deal with your doubt and your fear and anxiety and insecurity. Meekness to deal with your pridefulness and self-seeking and lack of forgiveness and lack of forgiveness and lack of forgiveness and lack of forgiveness. I'll give you this fruit. And you see, let me tell you again, the fruit can overrule. The problem is we wait too late to let the fruit come in and take over. Most marriages in trouble can be fixed. Let me say that to the world, those listening, those here, most marriages can be fixed, but it takes something you're not ready to give. That's yourself, your pride, your opinion, your desire to be right, your desire to win. It don't mean squat. You want to save your marriage? You got to be like Christ. Open not his mouth. Mistreated, but not mistreated in return. Spent all night in prayer. See, the real question becomes, are you willing to pay the price? Do not take God cheaply. I've seen God take some marriages that people thought, and those folks, not only are they together, they're better, they're happier, but they both had to sell completely over to Jesus Christ the righteous. He will milk you and bleed you of yourself. But our problem is we have an agenda we don't want to let go. We go into marriage with what we want, seeking what we desire. We go into marriage to receive, not to give. And we got all these pictures about how it's going to be for me. And many of those pictures we never discussed with the person we were marrying. We just expected them to step up and fill our dreams. But the fruit of the Spirit, self-control, to take care of our rage, anger, jealousy, and that most dangerous word of all in marriage, blame. 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 I can tell you this, after 40-some years, it can get better. And you see, it really doesn't, it doesn't get better because you stop having arguments and misunderstandings. Now, we have gotten by the argument stage. Sister Wright and I figured out about 10 years ago, 15, argument is just a big waste of time. You get done, you're tired. You don't feel good. Come on, y'all, you don't feel good. You know, and walk around in their corner. They're two grown people, their corner. Walk past each other, don't speak. That's just dumb. Don't speak. And then walk by them so they can see that you're not gonna speak yet. That's stupid. Grown people!
with jobs running other people. No. Waste of time. Just leave it alone. You know, leave it alone. You know, and you learn. You know, something just ain't worth it. Just you know, let it go by. That's why the room has, you know, 5, 6, 7 rooms in it. You find a room. They got their room over there. Work it out with Jesus. Come on back. You know, hug each other. You know, do something nice. But don't dwell on that thing. It just drains you. Drains you. When you come to church, your face is all sore. I can tell when you get out the car. You know, bam. Oh, me. Here they are. They argue. You know, don't even look back. Get out the car. Swishing, you know. Don't look back, you know. And the last Sabbath, he rushed around, opened the door. You know, he drives off before you even get out the car. Yeah. Absolute waste of time and human energy. How many of y'all know I'm telling the truth? I want to say one more thing to you, then I need my song. Listen to the pastor. Great marriages make great churches. That's why no matter what you bring to me, pastor prays for you, agonizes for you. My heart gets filled with tears. My eyes gets wet. My face gets wet with tears because I love you. And I've seen what God can do. Amen. Come on, y'all. Amen. I told you, the marriage is like the relationship with Jesus Christ. And there's going to be people in heaven that nobody thought would be there. You ought to praise God for yourself. Come on now. Gonna be folks who nobody thought would make it in. They're going through the gate. Why? Because they gave themselves to Jesus Christ. Take yourself to Jesus. I said, take yourself to Jesus. Keep most of your married problems between you and Jesus. The Holy Spirit can take your marriage, feeble though it may be, make it a trophy to the grace of God. The love of God can do that. What do you say? Amen. God bless you. Watching me in other settings, maybe husband and wife together. Just grab each other's hand right now and squeeze that hand and ask the Lord to help you. Maybe it's not going good for you, but you can pray.
you can try harder by God's grace. Don't give up. Don't give up. Make your home, your marriage, a victory to Jesus Christ. To those of you here, I offer the same. I'm not going to do anything dramatic like having all the husbands and wives stand up and all that kind of thing. You can settle this right there in your pew. Any of us who are married know that it takes some work. But remember, it's a spiritual relationship. It'll be settled by spiritual principles. I've just shared a few. Not by winning arguments, not by one-upsmanship, not by demeaning the other person. Christian principles. Bow your heads. Let me pray for the marriages now. Father in heaven, we're seeking the Holy Spirit in all that we do. And so as my dear sister now sings this second verse, I dedicate this verse to the marriages. Please, sister, sing. We're all praying.
When hoary time shall pass away,
yes, Jesus,
and earthly thrones and kingdoms fall, when men who hear refuse to pray,
I said that the relationship of a husband and wife, parallels that of our relationship with Jesus Christ. Maybe somebody today has been in a divorce relationship with Jesus, or you've never said yes to his appeal to be the love of your life. You've been thinking about becoming a part of this church. You've been thinking about taking Bible studies. Maybe transferring your membership. God's love reaches out to you today and you'd like to come forward. You'd like to come forward. The Holy Spirit is saying, come and give yourself to Jesus Christ. And you want to do that right now, please, as she sings this next verse, just rise and come wherever you are. Church is praying for you. Just get up and come. Who will do it?
Could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk
downstairs
of earth
can come,
a quill,
upstairs
and
can come,
every man a scribe,
balcony's not too far.
Drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure,
yes,
how measureless.
See if somebody who's trying to talk it through with Jesus gives in and comes on.
Please. Please. Finish my prayer now. Father, thank you so much for speaking to our hearts today. Be thou kind to that soul with whom you now wrestle and yet holds out. Maybe even at the door, as happened so many Sabbaths, they'll come and say, I should have come. Present themselves to you. But thank you for speaking to us today. We have much to think about. In Jesus' name, and the people said, amen. Are you glad you came to church today? Now, whenever I preach a sermon like this, I always like to just say, if I said anything that offended anyone, was not intentional, that most things I said today, you know me, I meant it. I meant it. I meant it. God help us. God bless us. The elder now will call for the tithes and offering.
The story is told of a man who had nothing, and God gave him 10 apples. 9 of the apples were used to buy food, shelter, and clothing. And the last apple God gave him as a gift to give back to him for giving him the other 9. So the man used the 9 apples that God had given him to buy food, shelter, and clothing. But the last apple, the man held for himself. He figured that God had everything. He had all the other apples of the world, so he wouldn't miss this one. So the man ate the apple and gave God the core. God has given each of us apples to supply our needs, plus at least one which we may show our gratitude to him. In many instances, God is given the leftovers or the core. Scripture teaches we should give God first. Honor the Lord with the substance and with the first fruits of our increase. The choice is yours. Will you return to God the large and juice of the apple or the core? May the deacons come forward to take this morning's tithe and offerings.
We've reached back into the music archives, and the song says, "You don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. You don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me."
You don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. You don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. You don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. You don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. You don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. You know He saved me.
He saved me.
He raised me.
He raised me.
Now I got the victory. Look what He's done for. Look what He's done for. What He's done for me. You don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. You don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. You don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. You know He saved me.
He saved me.
He raised me.
He raised
me. Now I got the victory. Look what He's done for. Look what He's done for. What He's done for me.
Father, we return unto Thee what Thou have given us. Please bless it for Your blessings. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Do not forget the
prayer meeting, of course, this coming Wednesday at 7:30. Do not forget the memorial service for Kathy Vess Thursday here at the church, 12 noon. I need more of us to be thinking seriously about our church budget and the amount of money we're giving there as a regular part of your giving. And then several of you have been wanting the handouts of the various things I've been presenting about temperaments. I have done up a special handout, a composite, that's back at the head greeter's table right now. First come, first serve. Reason I didn't do enough for everybody is because I find them all over the pews and so forth and so on, which tells me you really didn't want it anyhow. So it's back there. There's about maybe 100 first come, first serve. You can get that and use it to your benefit if you can. It's been a good day in church, hasn't it? Our service this evening starts at 5. Remember, greeting the family. Memorial service at 5:30. God bless you. Let us stand as we close our service.
Ushers will escort you out. Happy Sabbath. Be blessed.